Well, good evening, everybody. It doesn't seem very long ago since some of us were here in the autumn thinking about gardens and artists. And now we're going to be looking at something rather different this evening. I'm Martin Postle. I'm the Deputy Director of Grants and Publications here at the Arts Centre. And it's my pleasure to introduce the first talk in our spring lecture course, a series which has now been running for over 3 years, since November 2015, so you may remember that. Well, tonight's our first speaker in the series, we have five different speakers, is Robert Willcock. Since completing his PhD in 2013, Sean has held teaching positions at the University of York and Queen Mary and the University of London. Sean's research, as he notes, examines the interrelationships between aesthetic practices and geopolitical violence during the Victorian period, with a particular focus on colonial photography and 19th century South Asia. Sean has already established a close relationship with Cornell Centre. He was a postdoctoral fellow here in 2016. He has published in our in-house journal, British Art Studies, and those of you who don't know, I do recommend you have a look at it, our online journal. Sean has published there an article on Dr. John Nicholas Treseder's photographs of war and peace in British India. He participated at a conference that we held called Photography in Britishness, and that was held at our sister institution, the Yale Centre for British Art, in November 2016. And if you're interested in that, it was 2 years ago, it is online, and you can still see it if you go to our website. And Sean has even taught our Yale undergraduates for us here in London at BMC, and he's currently has a Leavitt Fellowship for 3 years. And he's working on a number of things all over the place, and he's also working on his first book, which examines the visual cultures that developed in tandem with the political and military crises that characterized British engagements, India and its borderlands during the 19th century. This evening, in the first lecture in the course, Sean's going to provide us with an introduction to the series, What is Photography? So, Sean, thank you very much.
So, welcome everybody to the series. Today I just want to give a bit of a sort of introduction to the origins and early uses of photography, and also introduce a few of the ways that the early practitioners themselves and also subsequent historians and theorists have thought about photography, and in particular how they've addressed this question, what photography essentially is. So we will start, in a sense, photography's beginning. This is a little bit of a sort of difficult matter. Now, if you were ever asked in a pub quiz when photography was invented, the answer they would be looking for would be 1839. This is the year that the French Academy of Sciences saw the announcement of photography to great fanfare and excitement. If you are asked when the first photograph was made, the answer is a little messier than that. Now, we don't actually have the first photographs that have ever been created. These would have been the transitory results of scientific experiments with light-sensitive compounds and optical instruments, the first brief flickerings of medium eventually come to dominate culture at a global scale. These images would have lasted for maybe seconds or minutes or hours, but there was no way of stabilizing the chemical process, so the solution would just continue to react to light until every element of the image blackened. So the photographs would exist only really as fleeting images, visible for a brief time and then fading away, sort of like a Polaroid working in reverse. The earliest existing photograph that we have, you see here, was made in 1826 by the French amateur scientist Joseph Misebourg Niépce, 1826 being over 10 years before the official announcement of photography, of course, in 1839. Cameras in themselves were not new. By the time that this photographic picture was made, taken from Niépce's country house, out the window of his country house in France. The optical instrument of the camera had been around for hundreds of years, but it had never been used to create anything quite like this before. The pinhole device, known as the camera obscura, had been invented by an Arabian physicist in the 11th century. It had been well known in Europe since the Renaissance, being instrumental in producing linear perspective amongst those artists. A camera obscura is essentially a box of any size with a small hole in one part of it. Light penetrates into this, and then, as if sort of by magic, an inverted image of what is outside is cast on the back wall. The images then are effectively live transmissions of whatever the pinhole is pointed at, history's first motion pictures. But these were inherently impermanent, and a sort of weird apparition of the world outside rather than a proper picture. They are inherently transient. So how to make these sorts of images permanent? This is the question that people like Niépce, Daguerre, and Talbot, whom we'll look at in a short while, were obsessed by. Niépce's answer was to harness the properties of bitumen Judea, this is an asphalt that reacted with light, in order to capture the fugitive images he could see in his camera. Now there is something rather wonderful, I think, about this faded representation of Niépce's window. There is a matter of factness to its experimentation with photosensitive chemicals. The photograph shows the view from outside the window because, of course, the window is where the light source was strongest. Very little of the scene is composed, as things would be later in quite artful ways by Daguerre and Henry Fox Talbot. Instead, what we see here is a fairly unceremonious seeming experiment by a man in a room with a pinhole camera. The artistic particulars of the scene are more or less incidental, they're subordinated to the light-based science. This could have been any well-lit area. But this one is embalmed for us. Light from the sun bounces off the buildings of this rural estate, and it reacts with a chemical solution that's been smeared like tar over a pewter plate, and it leaves us with this visual trace of the scene as it appeared for a brief window in time in 1826. It's worth stepping back for a moment, I think, sort of forgetting about the fairly deadening ubiquity of photographic images today, just marvelling at the kind of strangeness of having this kind of window into the 19th century. What makes this sort of image different from a sketch or a painting? Why is it that when looking at a photograph, we have a sense of being more intimately connected to the thing that it represents? After all, in this, we can hardly actually see anything. A painting or a sketch will give us much more clarity about this scene. Indeed, this one is an enhanced version of the original. The original is much more faded, almost invisible, so that in fact the first photograph in existence hardly really exists at all. But I actually think this image is even more sort of wonderful than the enhanced version. I think when we look at this, we get a much more tangible sense, this undoctored photograph, of what photography essentially is. Now, Niépce called his process heliography, so this is the writing of the sun. And we get a sense of that here. The shapes we see are the result of this physical reaction to the presence of light. It's discoloration, sort of emerging like sunburnt skin, corrosive searing of the sea onto a photosensitive emulsion. This link, the photographic image, to the actual light conditions of the scene that it represents, this physical link is called an indexical relationship. That is to say, something physically caused by the thing that it represents. So for example, my handprint would be an index of my hand, and therefore by extension an index of me. My footprint, an index of my foot, and an index of me. An index of something doesn't actually have to look like the thing that it's indexing. A sunburn is an index of the sun. The wonderful thing about photography is that it's both indexical and iconic. It's caused by the thing it represents, and it also looks like the thing it represents. So we have this much more intimate connection. A photograph requires the physical presence of things, me, seen like this, in front of the camera, assuming suitable light conditions. Niepce's photograph is touched by the light of 19th century France. The intellectual Roland Barthes, during a period of grieving, encountered a picture of his recently deceased mother as a young girl. And it was a real sort of emotional gut punch for him. And he tried to account for the extraordinary power photography has over us in terms of its indexicality. He said that when we look at a photograph, it doesn't feel like we're looking at a copy of the world in the same way as when we look at a sort of portrait or a landscape produced by the artist's pencil or paintbrush. This feels like a copy of the world. They look like it, but it's still just a copy. With a photograph, he says, it feels like, indeed it is, an emanation of that past reality. It emanates from a previous reality. And in this sense, he argues, photography feels much more like a magic than it does an art, or indeed a form of science. Now the results of a photograph may well appear to be sort of magical. Production of one, especially in the early stages, was a product of slow, painful, laborious science. Estimates of the exposure time needed to make this image come in at around 8 hours. This is not a convenient method of making representations, and indeed, photography would not be the kind of convenient image-making tool we think of it today, for another few decades. If you look here, this is the photographic van of Roger Fenton, a famous photographer who went out to the Crimean War in the 1850s. This is his assistant sitting there. Fenton needed this van because he needed a traveling laboratory in order to prepare the negatives and develop the negatives. He simply couldn't do it otherwise. So this is not the kind of easy take your phone out, press a button that we are used to today, although something like, something akin to that does come along in 1888 with the Kodak point and shoot camera, this pithy slogan, you press the button, we do the rest. Niepce died in 1833, but his experiments in photography were continued by a fellow Frenchman. We'll get to the English stuff later. This is the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art. It is coming, I promise. Let's get through this French stuff first. So his fellow Frenchman, the flamboyant theatre designer, Louis-Jacquemont Daguerre. Now Daguerre had been conducting some experiments of his own. but without significant yield. He was a businessman, and he saw the profit potential of this new tool for producing images. He didn't want to be picked to the post for making a profit. He therefore proposed a partnership with the apps, and he gleaned some useful knowledge from him in a period of correspondence. So when the apps died, the fatal stroke, Daguerre went on to refine the pair's process over the next few years, modestly turning it Daguerreotype. But you can see the extraordinary level of progress that is being made here in terms of the details captured. In an 1838 pamphlet written for potential investors in this nascent technology, Daguerre claims, I quote, "The daguerreotype is not merely an instrument which serves to draw nature. On the contrary, it is a chemical and physical process which gives her the power to reproduce herself." So it's the physics of light and innovations of chemistry that are being accounted for in such images. The idea of human intervention, authorial intervention, this is being sidelined in the promotional literature in favor of promoting scientific objectivity of photography. We'll get to what that might mean in a few moments. The daguerreotype itself, as you can see here, it's slightly sort of strange looking images. And these are unique, it's a one of a kind photographs. They're not reproducible. So this element of reproducibility, which we think of as being basically integral to what photography is, this is absent from some of the earliest incarnations of the medium. These are just as unique as a painting would be. They had a famously long exposure time, and this leads to the slightly kind of stiff postures that we see in a lot of early photographs. But for all that, the level of detail in the final product could be quite stark. I mean, note, for instance, here, this kind of arresting articulation of the veins of Daguerre's hand. This is a long way indeed from that view outside of Niepce's window in 1826. Now, I could go on about sort of processes. Quite dry stuff, but it is, I think, very useful to get a sense of what it meant to produce one of these daguerreotypes, to get a sense of the labour involved in early photography.
People from all walks of life could now afford to have their portraits made, and they did. For all their popularity, producing daguerreotypes was a labor-intensive process requiring a lot of equipment and skill. The daguerreotype plate is made of copper faced with silver. To secure it and make it easier to handle, the plate is placed silver side up on an adjustable block. In order to prepare the plate for exposure, it has to be polished. In this modern demonstration of the daguerreotype process, the daguerreotypist applies a small amount of rotten stone to a cloth almost in the diameter of the alcohol. The daguerreotypist applies the alcohol and rotten stone to the surface of the plate using a consistent motion. The daguerreotypist sprinkles a fine red powder known as rouge onto a long pale stick. The plate is then buffed using the rouge. Polishing the plate in the same direction improves viewing of a high reflective surface. The plate is then buffed a second time with a clean padded stick in order to increase its reflectivity. It is now ready to be made by the sensor. In the dome, the daguerreotypist places the polished plate face down in the sensitizing box, which contains a small amount of iodine crystals. In about 15 to 45 seconds, fumes from the iodine react with the silver, coating the plate with silver iodine. This process would then be repeated with fumes from bromide or quicksilver. From sensitizing box, the daguerreotypist removes the plate, now coated with bromo iodide of silver. The plate is now light sensitive and ready for use in the camera. The daguerreotypist places the light sensitive plate in the plate hole with the coated side down. It is then secured into place. The viewing glass is lifted out of the camera and replaced with the loaded plate hole. The double screen is removed to make the plate accessible for the exposure. To make the exposure, the daguerreotypist removes the lens plate. Early exposure times were notoriously long and sometimes uncomfortable, often taking more than 20 seconds. To ensure that the sitter did not move during the exposure, the 1940 Boston newspaper recommended the following.
His head should be placed on a semicircle of iron and fitted to the back of the chair. He should fix his eyes on some well-defined object in any direction which he may prefer. Now, if everything is arranged as it should be, you need to report him in less than 20 seconds and in the most satisfactory manner.
In the dawn, the daguerreotypist develops the plate. A few ounces of liquid mercury are very carefully poured into a flaring iron vessel, heated by an alcohol lamp. The exposed plate is removed from the plate placed face down in the mercury chamber, which is heated to approximately 175 degrees Fahrenheit. After mercury vapor reacts with the sensitized silver, the daguerreotypist removes the developed plate. The daguerreotypist then fixes the plate, making it safe for viewing in normal light by pouring on it a solution of hyposulfite of silver. This removes the excess bromoiodide of silver, not acted upon by light in the camera. After it has been thoroughly washed, a gilding stand is used to finish the plate. A weak solution of chloride of gold is gently heated over an alcohol lamp. This hardens the plate and adds to the beauty and permanence of the image. After a final cleaning of the plate, the daguerreotype is assembled for safekeeping and display. The plate is put into a shallow hinged case that includes decorative mat and preserver, both of bronze, and a glass cover with tape edges. Daguerreotype studios presented their wares in a variety of cases, ranging from simple leather or hot cotton.
So this is not an easy thing. Could you get these objects from the process that are kind of treasured material items, things that people handle, and indeed to properly look at the daguerreotype, you have to hold it in a certain way, because otherwise the light reflects off it, and you basically just see a reflection of yourself trying to look at the daguerreotype. So they're very tactile things. People are astonished by this method of image making when it's announced in France on the 7th of January 1839. It makes Daguerre famous throughout Europe, yet largely forgotten by this point. But the particulars of the process that we've just seen were initially kept from the public. Daguerre was locked in talks with the French government over the rights to his technique. The state ultimately acquired Daguerre's wondrous formula, and in a fairly utopian gesture, they made it available for use without any patent restrictions. This paved the way for the extraordinarily vast and wide-ranging spread of daguerreotypes across the world over the next decade. Within months of its official announcement, the technology had gone global, being produced everywhere from America to India. And this is particularly remarkable given the journey time. In 1839. Within decades, there were many more convenient ways of producing photographs, and photography had embedded itself in pretty much all aspects of modern life. Middle-class portraiture, mugshots, photomicroscopy, photography as a fine art, photography is anthropology, archaeology, botany, pornography. No other image-making technology had experienced this kind of degree of impact and ubiquity so quickly. The world, it seems, was really ripe for photography in 1839. And Daguerre and his deceased partner were not the only ones who would be experimenting with optical instruments and photosensitive chemicals. Across the English Channel, one man in particular was greatly perturbed by Daguerre's announcement, William Henry Fox Talbot, the English inventor of photography, had been tinkering with photographic processes for a few years. He was a landed gentleman and an intellectual polymath. His interests ranged from linguistics to mathematics, and photography was therefore only one element of his sort of wide-ranging interests. And I think partly because of this, he failed to properly grasp the potential public interest of what he was doing. He didn't really bother to adequately finesse or publicize his experiments as he was conducting them over the 1830s. So when in 1839 news of Daguerre's photosensitive image-making process emerged from France, Talbot was alarmed. I quote him, "I was threatened with the loss of all my labour in case Monsieur Daguerre's process proved to be identical with mine, and in case he published it at Paris before I had time to do so in London." So all is not lost for Talbot. His initiative was only the fact of Daguerre's discovery has been announced, not the precise methodology. It still talks to the French government. Talbot is therefore afforded a window of opportunity to announce his own technique before Daguerre could make his method public. So Talbot works up his findings and he gives a paper to the Royal Society in February 1839, essentially trying to seize the initiative. The paper he gave had this title: "Some account of the art of photogenic drawing, or the processes by which natural objects may be made to delineate themselves without the aid artist's pencil." So again, note the promotion of objective natural processes and the sidelining of human agency here, really emphasizing photography's status as a science. Talbot himself had pretty good reason for wanting to sideline the artist's pencil. Talbot was good at pretty much everything. He was a talented mathematician, talented linguist, talented botanist, talented chemist. He was not a talented draftsman. Talbot told the story of his honeymoon in 1833, when he and his wife sat overlooking Lake Como in Italy with a camera lucida. This is a device that refracts an image of the surrounding landscape through a prism so that when it's held correctly, it casts, sort of like the camera obscura I saw earlier, casts an image of the landscape onto a page. And you can then use this as a drawing aid. You can trace that image to help you, and then when you take the camera away, you are left with something like this. Talbot was really disappointed with what he was left. He was absolutely entranced by the vibrancy and magic of the images which were cast on the page. Then you take the camera away and suddenly all of that vibrancy, all of that magic is lost. His outlines pale in comparison to what he called the inimitable beauty of the pictures of nature's painting which the glass lens of the camera throws upon the paper. Fairy pictures, creations of a moment, destined rapidly to fade away. So Talbot sets out to capture these fairy pictures, as he calls them. This won't be the only discussion of fairies actually in this talk, or we'll be looking at some photographs of fairies a little later on. He sets out to capture these in his capacity as an amateur scientist. So through the next few years, he makes numerous experiments and invents not just one mode of photography, but many. The first of these was the photogram, or what Talbot termed photogenic drawing. This didn't use a camera at all. Instead, it was made like a sort of contact print, whereby something, usually a kind of botanical specimen, was placed directly onto a sheet of paper coated in salt and silver nitrate and then exposed to light. And these objects would leave an impression of themselves on the page. This cameraless method was later rediscovered by the surrealist photographer Man Ray, who's seen there on the right, in the early 20th century. He really liked the sort of the oniric, the dreamlike qualities of these images, and then he terms this process the rheograph. Daguerreotype, rheograph, we're about to have a talbotype. There's a lot of narcissistic christenings. But so far then we've got a daguerreotype, which is a form of photography which is not reproducible. And we've got a photogram, which is a form of photography which doesn't even use a camera. So both of these are making use of light sensitivity to produce their images. Therefore, both forms of light writing, photography, photo, light graphy, writing, what this term designates. But they're quite a long way away from what we think of as photography today. You have a camera, take a picture, and then you can infinitely reproduce the results. But it was Talbot who first started to work on this kind of more modern process of photography. This is what he called Talbotype, or the calotype as it's otherwise known. Here we see the first image produced, this kind of this first negative image, negative, positive. Again, the window, pretty indistinct, kind of reminiscent of the apse. Most of the images from Talbot's famous book on photography, The Pencil of Nature, 1844, were calotypes. This book, some of you may have had a look at before the talk, functions as a sort of manifesto for photography. Talbot is essentially promoting the utility of his invention here. He alights on everything from making facsimiles of pieces of text, he's just photographing old manuscripts to show the utility of photography as modes of mechanical reproduction. He's also taking photographs of household items. And in his little note for this one, he says, wouldn't it be great if you had a photograph like this and you were robbed and you could show this in the court? How useful would that be? So he's thinking in really wide-ranging terms, thinking for insurance purposes. I mean, the book is quite extraordinary in how many applications of photography manages to envision very, very quickly indeed. Talbot, by the way, might get themselves to the French government and then release daguerreotype without patent restrictions. Talbot is very, very keen on the patent restrictions and he ruthlessly enforces the patent on his process. So on the one hand, he's showing this instrumentality of photography. But he's also creating images of real beauty, such as this bust, in which he's experimenting with light and shade, taking it from different angles. It's a kind of expressiveness to this. He's also producing homages to artistic traditions such as still life photographs, kind of a weird concept, landscapes, and then also the everyday picturesqueness of the Dutch school. Something like this, everyday, unremarkable scene, which nevertheless has this sense of sort of compositional satisfaction, has this sense of picturesqueness. And Talbot writes beneath this image that he thinks photography is going to be able to help essentially train the eye to see things more artistically. So in a way that previously only people who were talented artists, he's got a little bit of a chip on his shoulder about not being very good with the pencil, I think. People who were only talented artists would have been able to see the world artistically. Suddenly now he's saying photography will sort of democratize that aesthetic experience, the aestheticization of the everyday. He's particularly enraptured with the details of his prints, and he recommends using a magnifying glass to fully appreciate an image. So presented, for instance, with a photograph of a wall, Talbot and Victorian critics following in his footsteps would get their magnifying glass out and try and see if there were little inscriptions on the wall that they could make out, or simply count the bricks. Being seriously, counting the bricks is a fairly common trope of photography criticism in the 19th century. It seems kind of boring to us now, but really such an activity is reveling in the fact that the human capacity to see has been enhanced. Talbot's method, or photography more generally, surpasses the capacities of previous modes of image making and even of the human eye. He writes in his description of this photograph of a haystack, I quote, "One advantage of the discovery of the photographic art will be that it will enable us to introduce into our pictures a multitude of minute details which add to the truth and reality of the representation, which no artist would take the trouble to copy faithfully from nature." So photography, again, outperforming artists in pencil, Talbot trying to render art a little less significant than it once was. He goes on to write, "It frequently happens, and this is one of the charms of photography, that the operator himself discovers on examination, perhaps long afterwards, that he has depicted many things he had no notion of at the time." So the photographer himself is not fully in control of the image in the same way that an artist, any detail the artist adds, he subconsciously adds that detail. This is not the case with photography. So photography emerges as a sort of optical prosthesis. It appears to enhance the Victorian capacity to notice things about their world. So when a critic was counting bricks, they were reveling in these transformed faculties, much like we might do with kind of zooming in and out on Google Earth today. Walter Benjamin, speaking of photography's ability to record these sorts of details that are missed by the natural human eye, coined the term the optical unconscious. The camera opened up, he argued, this optical unconscious for us. Things which had always been sort of literally there in front of us for us to see, but which we never really consciously registered. I quote him here, "Even if one has a general knowledge of the way people walk, one knows nothing of a person's posture during a fractional second of the stride." Benjamin is writing in the 1930s, and he can look back on an early history of photography that has radically altered the relationship between reality and vision, between the way things truly were and the way they happened to be perceived by fallible human eyes. You see here Edward Muybridge's photographs of people walking. We'll have a look at horses galloping in a moment. These open up a kind of strange new visual world in which familiar movements are rendered alien, in which the very gait of a person is shown to contain elements of the unseen. Muybridge was an English photographer who emigrated to America, where, among other things, he photographed the American West, made his breakthrough studies of human and animal locomotion, and murdered his wife's lover. For his famous horse series, Muybridge set up cameras with an exposure time of 1/1000th of a second. This laid the foundations for the invention of film. Again, we're a very long way from the Epps's 8 hours now. In doing this, he settled the debate as to whether all four hoofs left the ground at the same time during a horse's gallop. This phenomenon not detectable by the human eye, clear as day when the movement was fragmented into these split second frames for the camera. So part of the addictive, the compulsive quality of photographs results from this promise that it has to extend our normal capabilities, not to simply reproduce sight, but to enhance it, to correct it, to teach it. Talbot is talking about this in The Pencil of Nature, Walter Benjamin is talking about this in the 1930s, I think it's something we still appreciate now. Photography, as critics like Susan Sontag have remarked in one of the suggested texts for this evening, is often about this sort of fantasy of power, an almost imperialistic engagement with the world in which we seek to master and own things that would otherwise escape our ken. At the same time, photography's unveiling of the optical unconscious, this universe of the overlooked, serves to highlight our failings. At the very moment of triumph, when the gallop of a horse is comprehended, we are at the same time shown how limited our natural vision can be, how much we are normally missing. So the camera is embraced by science as a tool akin to the microscope or the telescope. It's a technological enhancement of the human sensorium. To use some trendier day theoretical parlance, it turns us into cyborgs. The camera is part of this broader technological revolution. It showed us that the world was not all that meant the naked eye. The question becomes, how far can we trust the camera to show us things that cannot be verified by normal vision? This is a question raised in particular by the phenomenon of spirit photography. Almost as soon as there are photographs, there are fake photographs. Almost as soon as photography is touted as having this kind of privileged purchase on truth-telling, it's giving rise to healthy levels of skepticism about how truthful a photograph really is. One of the famous early spirit photographers is William H. Mumler, an American Boston-based resident who initially produced these images by mistake from not cleaning plates and then went on simply to make a roaring trade from producing them for credulous viewers. When a normal portrait was selling for around 25 cents, he was selling his spirit photographs for $10. So this was lucrative. Mumler operated in a really kind of theatrical manner. He would hover his hands dramatically over the camera as he was producing the images, and he incorporated his wife, who was a spiritualist, into the proceedings. And so the two claimed that it was sort of partly their presence that was invoking these spirits. Many people were, of course, skeptical, and some demanded that Mumler essentially submit to scientific protocol. They watched him as he worked. They gave him negatives to work from. And yet, in spite of watching him hawkishly, somehow, through some kind of sleight of hand, he still managed to pull it off. He still produced spirit photographs. So he's a canny operator. But he did slip up. One man who at first was a believer suddenly came to be a fierce critic of Mumler after he noticed in one of the photographs that he'd been given that the spirit in that photograph was someone he knew to be alive and well at the time. In spite of this, though, Dr. Gardner still keeps his faith in spirits. I quote, "While I am fully in the belief that genuine spirit likenesses have been produced through his mediumship, so he even believes Mumler's spirits, evidence of deception in two cases at least has been furnished me. Mumler has been guilty of deception in palming off his genuine spirit likenesses, pictures of a person who is now living in his city. He also did The Spirit of Abraham Lincoln. He really eventually, this all catches up with him. In 1869, he's arrested in New York and is charged with fraud. His defense brought in photographers and even scientists to attest to the fact that they could see nothing fraudulent in his practice when they watched him. The prosecution, meanwhile, brought in photographers who basically said, look, we can all do this. We know the techniques involved in producing a spirit photograph. These are fakes. But ultimately, because nobody had actually been caught in the act, Mumler was acquitted. He remained, by that point, a pariah of the photographic community. Now, this trial highlights two ways in which spirit photographs were treated. So on the one hand, photographers know how to make these. Many do so without claiming that it's a real spirit. They just do it out of a sense of fun and entertainment. On the other hand, the way they're made, it's double exposure. So the negative is exposed twice, meaning that the ghostly trace of the first portrait can be seen in the second image. And later on, as fashions change, you get fewer figures like this, and they start to manipulate the negative with kind of abstract patterns that's supposed to represent ectoplasm. People move with the times to a degree in spirit photography. But they're also drawing on science as a sort of verification method. They're saying, look, we've gone through the scientific protocol and no one could see that Mumler was doing anything wrong. Therefore, this must be a scientific verification of ghosts. Now, this seems strange to us. These sorts of practices would seem to be in stark opposition to science. But then again, science in the 19th century had thrown up all sorts of wonders that just a few years earlier would have seemed like magic. Phenomena, undetectable to the human eye, had been discovered repeatedly. Infrared, ultraviolet, bacteria, X-ray imaging, radioactivity, all of these attested to forces operating beyond human perception. In other words, developments in science were leading to a view of the world which, under a certain interpretation, would lend credence to spiritualist claims that there were, in fact, ghosts present in our world. They simply existed at a frequency imperceptible to the human eye, but which was picked up on by the camera. So as much as science was disenchanting and demystifying, it's also pointing to these unseen, mysterious, not fully understood forces. And photography embodied this paradox. It was at once an instrument which was symbolic of rationality and empirical observation, a disinterested and dryly objective enterprise, merely the pencil of nature, as Talbot called it. And at the same time, though, it appeared to be an eerie, an uncanny experience containing this aura of magic. And for all that we might consider ourselves immune to this kind of mysticism, we would nevertheless recoil at the thought of vandalizing a photograph of a loved one. Photographs do have a kind of power over us that exceeds rational appraisal at the time. Spirit photography in particular, then, was a practice that raised many questions about the nature of photography, its place within scientific inquiry, its status as evidence. These photographs are asserted as evidence by spiritualists, and scientific methods are also used to try and discredit them. At stake here is the validity of photography as a scientific verification of visual phenomena. And by and large, the public and the scientific establishment especially, they're not taken in by spirit photography. But it can't be dismissed as the belief of just a few crackpot Victorians. Its influence spread far and was strong even in the aftermath of the First World War. One of its leading proponents was Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the author of Sherlock Holmes, the detective who epitomised Victorian rationality. Ghostly themes kind of permeate Sherlock Holmes' stories, but he's always committed to a rational explanation. Yet for their author, Conan Doyle, photography, spirit photography, was seemingly proof that ghosts were themselves now subject to rational investigation. Case for spirit photography on the right, and he was even taken in by famous Cottingley fairy images produced in 1917 and a few more in 1920. And these purported to show young cousins in Yorkshire playing with real life fairies in the back of their garden. And Conan Doyle used these as evidence in his book, The Coming of the Fairies. One girl's mother showed these at a spiritualist meeting, and to the disappointment of their father, whose camera they had used, and who was pretty convinced they were fake, but couldn't actually find any evidence from his daughter that they were, the girls never owned up. And actually, it wasn't until 1981 that one of the sisters finally admitted that photographs had been faked. They used drawings of fairies, cut out from card, and propped up using hatpins. Apparently they basically did it for everybody who had believed it to die before that. They didn't want to embarrass anybody. But these original prints sold recently at auction for £20,000. So such photography makes use of the photograph's seemingly authoritative realism. They do so in order to engage in fantasy and fiction. So while photography's indexicality, to go back to that, means that it is in some way an emanation of a past reality, as Barthes said, such things were there before the lens. Actually, in the final analysis, the relationship between indexicality and reality or truth, this is pretty precarious. The photographic historian John Tagg put this best, I think, in the 1980s, with this question. Ask yourself, under what conditions would a photograph of the Loch Ness Monster or an unidentified flying object become acceptable as proof of their existence? The photograph alone, he is suggesting, is insufficient. It is the context in which an image circulates and the pre-existing belief systems which it complements to ensure the evidential value of the photograph. Seeing a photo of a UFO circulating on some kind of obscure website is quite a different thing to encountering one in the front pages of the New York Times or in a secret government archive. And if we're more likely to accept the latter as proof than the former, it is because of our beliefs about the institution more than our faith in the image. The photograph itself is not sufficient. So to quote Tang again, photography as such has no identity. Its status as a technology varies with the power relations which invest it. Its nature as a practice depends on the institutions and agents which define it and set it to work. Its function as a mode of cultural production is tied to definite conditions of existence, and its products are legible and meaningful only within the particular currencies they have. Its history has no unity. It is a flickering across a field of institutional spaces. It is this field we must study, not photography as such. So what Tagg means here is that after a certain point, it becomes pointless to speak about the essential qualities of photography, as if indexicality could somehow serve as a guarantee of photographic realism. We must look instead at the context in which we encounter a photograph in order to appreciate its meaning. So this lecture series will consider a few such contexts. Next week, Patrizia Di Bello will look at photography's role in the domestic and familial sphere, considering how photographic portraiture in particular and the album transformed the way we relate both to ourselves and to others. Following that,
we have Juliet Hacking speaking about photography as art. So this is a very different rubric to the kind of scientific or pseudo-scientific discourses that we've outlined today. We will then have a lecture from Liz Wells discussing how photography has altered our relationship to nature and ecology. And then finally, the award-winning photographer Simon Norfolk will lead a discussion on the conventions of war photography. So while today's talk has briefly sketched photography's uncertain status as a science, this programme overall will go on to consider how the camera has informed our understanding of art, politics, nature, and the self. Now, for those of you who have read the Sontag text, I won't be quizzing you, you get a sense of how abrasive critics can be when considering photography. Photography tricks and deceives, it degrades and violates, it gives us shocks and then renders us numb. Quotes like this, "there is an aggression implicit in every use of the camera," have become a pillar of the university seminar room. Her uncompromising stance makes for good discussion and debate. What can she mean by this? I really like this quote in particular, because I typed the quote into Google a couple of years ago, and there's someone's put it on this inspirational poster kind of thing. And there's this kind of real dissonance between the sentiment of the quote and the photograph behind it, this nice, calm ocean sunset. But even on the front cover of Sontag's 1977 book, we get a photograph of two people holding another photograph in this kind of delicate, intimate, loving way. This is a familial image. It's a scene of love and maybe loss, but it doesn't instantly have us thinking about aggression. But for Sontag and many scholars in the decades following her, photography's power, its emotional punch, was distrusted. One photography historian recently wrote that it would appear most photography critics just really hate photography. Sontag's essay embodies this caustic position. But lately, there's been a bit of a sort of thawing in scholarship. The history of photography has become quite a big thing in the discipline of art history at the moment. Lots and lots of new publications, new research coming out. And so we've got a much more nuanced aesthetic, political, and ethical perspective on photography that is emerging today. So it's an exciting time, I think, to have this series of lectures on photography assessing its extraordinary impact on modernity. So I'll just finish with a quote which I've always liked from Susie Linfield writing in response to Sontag's description of photography as just kind of degrading everything. She says, "Try to imagine, if only for a moment, what your intellectual, political, and ethical world would be like if you had never seen a photo."
Thank you very much, Sean. Indeed, that was wonderful, a very nuanced account of. So I hope you all know what photography is now. We still have to go through another 4 weeks' time, and I love the way that you counterbalance the sort of scientific and the nuance and the emotive and the emanation, and then went through to the spirit world, which still goes on today, isn't it? Yeah. That's so fascinating. I was thinking about, I don't have a professional interest in photography, and I know very little about it. There's a photograph that I'm kind of, has captivated me at the moment. I'm working on a house called Rachel Door, which is in Norfolk. There's a woman called Brown Lady. And there's a photograph taken in 1935 by Country Life, and it's become a very famous photograph. And I was thinking about, and the reason I mention it is going downstairs, I've stayed at Lane, and I've even been there at midnight and kind of looked around. It's context, it's memory, isn't it? It's all about that, and I'm not going to bore you with that, but it just triggered something when you mentioned that. And I thought, of course, that photograph would never, had there not been a context, had there not been an expectation, had there not been all these multi layers, people would have shrugged and said, "So what?" Mm. So it's fascinating that there is this kind of context for a lot of these images, and I thought at the end, that's a lovely idea, an aggressive kind of balmy
scene. Yes.
Yeah. I'll shut up, but I'm sorry for that, I would say too much. Do we have any thoughts, comments, observations for Sean on anything you like? Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. A careful attention to detail. Yes, I think so. But again, with Talbot, it's maybe a bit of a cheeky reference in that he's just showing that you don't have to be a skilled Dutch artist to be. Again, he's kind of the word that Steve Edwards has used in his account of the early theorization of photography is de-skilling. The photography was seen to de-skill artistic labor in the same way that factories have de-skilled previous crafts. So photography is just this one more part of this sort of industrial revolution. Yes. Yes, his a lot of his images are very, very carefully composed, and particularly with the light and shadow, you get a real sense with those busts, for instance, of him moving around, and he talks about creating different mood effects. So he knows that the camera, there's this odd split in his writings on photography. On the one hand, he wants to say that nature does everything. There's no significant human intervention. But on the other hand, he's making these beautiful images and describing how he does so, which outlines precisely the extent of intervention that he's making in order to get these scenes.
I'm really struck by the haystack.
Yes. Yeah, he has, and actually with some photographs, not this one, but with ones like this, there are multiple ones, and then he's chosen where he likes the shadows to fall. So he's watching the light change, and you know it's a bit of a laborious thing to make a photograph. So partly that's just something that happens as you're making all those preparations, but he's watching the world change and then choosing those kind of decisive moments.
Yes.
Picking up on that, it's the connection between art and photography, and what he would say, photography in its beginning was very much related immediately to the arts. And the idea was, of course, one of the very close to the impressionist, and there's a lot of rivalry, a lot of interaction at the time. And all the earliest photography really was immediately influenced by artists.
Yes.
Yeah, I just see it as when you say the cyborg thing, I mean, it's human beings are a tool to make the animals.
Yeah.
I mean, basically, the artist is using tools of one kind or another, and the photographer is. And I see it as a continuation of that process of human development, really. Even the painter finds things that he wouldn't see.
Yes, absolutely. You will notice new things at sketching, but you are less likely to sketch something without consciously realizing that you're sketching it. Talbot's point with the photograph is that you can just click, and then when you develop it, there are all these kinds of aspects of the scene, and he's not just clicking. That's much more complicated than that at this stage. But there are all these elements of detail which he didn't even intend for. And sometimes he'll develop the negative once, and then he'll develop it a little bit more, and new details will emerge. So it's not even in the first photograph he produces, but it's kind of there embedded in the negative. And a lot of, to go back to this kind of idea of the optical unconscious, and all of these details which can get embedded in an image without consciously putting them there, scholars always bring up this notion of the punctum. And the punctum is from Roland Barthes, who I quoted a little bit in the talk. And he says that the thing about photography that really grabs you is the punctum. So the punctum is different to the studium. I'll explain these terms. The studium would be, for instance, you'd look at this and you'd say, the studium for this is its kind of cultural resonance, the fact that it's Dutch school of art, it relates to the Dutch school of art, the everyday, things like this. Things you can explain to other people fairly easily. The punctum would be some little detail that pricks, this is what punctum means, something that reaches out and pricks at you as an individual. And Bart says that photography in particular has the punctum rather than art, because the punctum needs to be unintended. It's something which the photographer didn't even mean to put there, and yet it's in the photograph, and then it emotionally impacts you. So for Barthes, the punctum can often be just a small item of clothing, a little facial expression, the fact that something in the background is moving in a way that the photographer wouldn't have intended. And he gets this real sense of a kind of aesthetic experience, an almost romantic experience from the punctum. And it's all because of this lack of artistic conscious control over what's being produced.
There is no selection. I mean, it's the inability to totally command.
Yes, yeah. I mean, I think when people talk about the punctum, they maybe overemphasize just how much all elements of a painting are under perfect conscious control of the artist.
It is the key that's moving the blurred in the background. Even now, it's still photographs.
Yes, yes.
There's nothing to believe even now. Your kids are in the back row.
Yeah, so for instance. So they're the part of the image, usually a small detail that pricks or wounds the viewer, having meaning for them on a personal level. So if we look at an image like this, this is a war photograph. You can categorize it really easily like that. At first, this looks like rubble. It's not. These are human remains. And then the punctum might be the fact that this horse is slightly blurred. It's moving. So you've got this colonial photograph of a war in India. These are Indian bodies spread in the foreground, Indian figures posed by a colonial photographer. It's this real expression of power in some ways. And then suddenly, the center of the image, an animal is moving. The photographer doesn't have control over that aspect. And it kind of gets away from that perfectly composed element. And that could be a sort of punctum, but the thing about the punctum is it's kind of it's an individual reaction to a photograph.
But isn't that just like you can never really film about it, you can never film about it as you see it. You can film it in one way, you can make a close-up, you can make shot, you can do a distance shot, you can do a top shot. But you can't ever really film it, because the way that we in an audience see that is, something
that's particular to us, what interests us in that split
second.
So
I'm not sure, can you really apply that sort of dictum to a photograph?
Well, the punctum I think Barthes's theory is quite a nice way to start thinking about photography in terms of studium and punctum. It gives you a nice little framework for sort of introduction. The punctum, it has become something by which scholars smuggle in personal reactions to photographs, which they can't necessarily back up in the traditional scholarly manner with evidence, footnotes, argument. So they cite the punctum and then they are kind of allowed, I think, this little flight of fancy, a bit of whimsy in response to the image. So I agree that it's a slightly nebulous concept. That's kind of almost its utility, I think, within the history of photography. But it does try to articulate what it is about photographs, particularly, which seem sometimes to have this strange evocative effect on us, that we can see an image from the past and there will be some small piercing detail from it which kind of reaches across to us, some element of reality seared into that photograph which wasn't necessarily even noticed by anyone at the time composing the scene, the photographer, the people posing, and it kind of reaches out to you. I think this is all, again, once you start talking about the punctum, it's the language around it is quite, struggling to think of a better word than flabby. It's not the kind, it's not the nice, taut scholarship that we like to make with footnotes and arguments, but that's almost the entire point, I think, of the concept. It's why it gets cited. So I think the punctum is probably cited more than anything else in the history of photography. And it's, I mean, I've been to conferences before where most of the papers will cite the punctum. It's almost like at some point you have to say, and this for me is the punctum. But the odd thing is that actually if you're being strict about Barthes' schema, the punctum is technically something you can't even communicate to somebody else. If you can communicate it coherently to somebody else, it's not the punctum, it's the studio. It's some part of the shared collective meaning. So actually, if you're being really strict with Barthes, and nobody is, including Barthes himself, because he's not consistent within his own text on it, the punctum is ineffable. There's kind of almost no punctum about it.
You think it's like Canaletto, who uses a camera obscura, who introduces punctums deliberately. You know, he's obviously, his main image is actually taken from a camera obscura, but then he's introducing things which actually deviate from the norm that you'd expect in that image, which is fascinating.
Yes.
Almost the accidental, and that's fascinating to take that. Yes.
Thanks, Sean. That was a very, very stimulating talk. I'm struck by how, right from the beginning, you get this photoshopping, this manipulation.
Yes.
And I mean, now we see, you know, women who have their lips changed to make them look beautiful, or their skin lightened or dark, whatever was going on. But I thought, well, this is interesting in the sense of we've got this technology which gives us reality, as you say, the indexical. But then immediately we think, ah, but we're being manipulated. This guy's doing spirit photography. We know that. The famous Trotsky photo where he's taken out of the Russian Revolution. So you're thinking, there's manipulation there right from the beginning. And then you think, well, you know, how do we trust anything? You know, we see, I mean, you can, a lot of conspiracy theories now, people say, well, that didn't really happen. We didn't go to the moon, it was just by a studio as a mock-up.
Yes.
So it kind of undermines, so as you say, you get this objective reality and then it's immediately taken away. The rug's pulled by saying, well, we're manipulating. We're manipulating you here. We're playing with you. And I think it's fair. I find it fascinating how all of us have to try and make that value judgments of trust. You know, is this photograph real?
Mm.
Has it been manipulated? Where's it coming from? Oh, it's in the Times. We trust the Times. What do you mean it's not? Yeah. It's in the Sun or whatever. I mean, there's lots of things there, aren't there?
Yes.
To that end,
that's not the kind of question I can just ask.
I know, but it's all perceived reality.
Yes.
So, even the photograph, I was wondering in the 19th century how much did people perceive the photograph as a representation of reality?
Yes. So, in what's happening in the 19th century is people are increasingly realizing that the world they see with their own eyes is not necessarily an objective reality, but that they're our human senses are partial, they're fallible. So in some ways, the photograph comes in to almost correct that, to show things which, like with the Moy Bridge, things that we ourselves couldn't see. So there's this kind of thirst for the real, thirst for objectivity, which photography satisfies. But then, as you say, immediately there are all of these fraudulent photographs which take away that sense of having some kind of purchase on reality.
There's all these weird photographs, not there, that Thomas Hardy did with his great friend in Dorset, where he created rustic life, but actually the life he was creating was the life that he wrote as a child, of course, the
yes.
And then he would do things like he would, I can't remember the name of his photographer, so he's referencing something like that, but he would make sure that the blouses were much more ripped and torn, or he'd have, but somehow even the most appalling north country setting, there might be, rather a nice kind of a letter print on the wall, which was ridiculous, what he was doing. It's that kind of fantastic way that he thought he was making things more.
Yes, yes. And a charity, Barnardo's, got in trouble in the 19th century for taking children, dressing them up as beggars, and then doing before and after scenes. So this is what they were like, and then we got involved, and now they're great. And this was exposed. So, yeah, I mean, the camera just becomes a kind of a theatrical zone in many ways. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Well, it depends what your aim with the photograph is. If the spiritualist stuff is particularly interesting, because they are actually, they're taking people who are often grieving or suffering from a sense of loss, and they're telling them that there are these sort of spirits contacting them from the other side. So that's much more kind of a straightforward case of fraud. But yes, I mean, you've got people like Oscar Raylander, who will be looking at, I'm sure, in Juliet Hacking's talk on art photography, who are producing scenes of lots of nudes all together, and this never actually existed. There are lots of separate studies which he's cut out and then produced a composite negative. So that's a fiction, in the same way that a sort of a classical painting would be a fiction, but he's presenting it as such, so it's not fraudulent.
Yes. I think at this point we're getting off one more question, and then we're going to I just don't want everybody to drift out the door.
Just a very well, thank you very much for the book. Julian Margaret Cameron, where did he sit in all this? This, you know, one sort of gets a perception of the nice people coming, doesn't it? Thank you for introducing us to it. Her name is always coming up.
I really love Julie Margaret Cameron's work. One of the brilliant things about her is that she starts to experiment with purposeful blurring. So things are out of focus, and it's part of the aesthetic effect. And critics at the time kind of think this is partly because she's a woman. They're just assuming that she can't get things into proper focus. But actually, you know, she's doing something different. So yeah, absolutely, she's taking photography in new directions.
Okay, well, I'd just like to thank you once more, Sean, for a very stimulating, very deep session to this. There's so much one can say about it. The thing is, we're all photographers these days, whether we like it or not. Our world has changed for better or worse. Next week, as Sean mentioned, we gave you a list of all the speakers, but we've got Dr. Patrizio Di Bello, who's a senior lecturer at Birkbeck, and she's going to be talking about portraiture, the album, and the self. So I do hope you can all make it next week. I think we're going to look forward to it. But just one more time to thank you.